Well, I've been called crazy. I've been called a few other things. Someone even said, "Why, you don't look like you've had a stroke." I said, "I didn't realize I looked that bad before then." The word still resonated in my mind growing up. My mother say, "Son, don't forget what I've told you. I want you to remember what I have told you." And I did my best to do that. And so I was praying and asking the Lord what to say to my church family this morning about my most recent episode. And the thoughts of what Mama said came back to me. Remind them to remember. Remind them not to forget. And here's what I want you to remember. Here's what I want you to not forget. You don't get rid of a car because it's got a flat tire.
There you go. Amen.
You'll get it in a minute. Oh, it's good to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
I want to thank you all for your prayers, for your support over the past few days. I don't believe anyone was any more shocked than I was about the events that took place. According to what the doctor is telling me, just got to make some lifestyle changes, and I've got to watch out about a few things. And I said, okay, I can do that. I can do that.
Sure.
And then Jimmy leads the song this morning. Any day now, we'll see. Amen. But from the bottom of my heart, thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support during this time. And I do ask that you continue to pray. We got some, as the old boy said, we got some obstacles in the way, but we're going to do all right. All right.
Yeah. Amen.
All right. We want to welcome you to Midway Baptist Church. It's good to see this number here this morning. And I pray that when you leave today, you'll say it was good to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And we welcome our viewers that are viewing us through electronic means. We're so glad to have them with us. And I want to say this. You know, last Sunday I was performing a wedding in North Florida. And they talked about a storm coming in, so I married them quick and got out. Anyway, I watched the service online. And it was fantastic. Choir, y'all sounded great. Amen. Congregational singing was great. And even the preaching was great. And I thank Brother Dr. for taking care of that. But we do welcome our visitors that are visiting by means of electronic means. This is Midway Baptist Church in Athens, Alabama. Let's go to the Lord in word and prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity that we have to be back in your house. Another opportunity, Father, to come together with brothers and sisters in Christ and with new faces, Lord, to be able to worship you, to be able to have a time where we just turn our thoughts and our feelings toward you. Lord, for that's, I believe, true worship. When we worship you in spirit and in truth, as Jesus said that we should. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We pray for everyone that is here today. Those, Lord, that are Christians, I pray they'll be lifted up. I pray that they'll be encouraged, edified, and perhaps even challenged.
Amen.
By what we see in your word.
Yes.
For the person that's not a Christian, I pray that your Holy Spirit conviction would speak to their heart.
Yes.
Father, that this would be the day that they would accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. Father, whatever the need may be that may be present in this place of worship or present at home or somewhere else where others may be viewing, whatever that need may be, May that need be met. And we pray it all in the lovely name of Jesus. In his name, amen.
Amen.
One quick reminder, now turn back to Brother Jim, is that at the conclusion of the service today, not only will we receive our normal offering, which you deposit in one of the receptacles, either here or back at the, call it back door, front door, whatever you can call it, there's one back there. We're going to receive an offering that is going to go towards hurricane disaster relief. And the church has already voted that we're going to put a good sum of money with whatever offering we get. But we want to give you an opportunity. And if you write a check for that, make it payable to Midway Baptist Church, and in the four space put for disaster relief. Don't put that offering in these boxes unless you've already done it. That's fine. We will have an offering plate that will be in one there, one back here, that you can put that offering in when you leave. Okay? Clear as mud.
Yes. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
God's good.
All the time.
God's good.
Pastor made me think of something that happened maybe 8 or 10 years ago. Now, it does apply to today. I want to make that clear. But our pastor was out. He'd been out a Sunday or two. I can't remember what the problem was, but he was very sick. And I called Linda up. Maybe on Wednesday or Thursday, and I said, how's Jerome doing? She said, well, he's feeling good, he's looking good. All right, he came back that following Sunday, sitting over here, and I said, well, Pastor, how are you feeling? He said, feel pretty good. I said, 1 out of 2, Kate's not feeling that bad. And he went up that foolishness, right? All right, if we're going to sing I'm Standing on the Solid Rock, that's Brother Bob Ward's favorite song.
Hey.
And here's what we're going to do after that second verse, of course. The band's going to play through a verse, and we're going to kick back in with that third verse. Is that okay?
Yes.
Maybe I'll remember that. All right, Standing on the Solid Rock.
Yeah.
little guys going to your special service, Big Pam and Cena in the back. Well, this morning we got Brother Jimmy, a.k.a. Oscar Walker, going to sing this morning. Always a blessing when a team sings right songs, sings, good musician. We're just really blessed people. And also after Jimmy sings, I think Brother Jim Hensley has something that he would like to take care of. Okay. Jimmy.
not going to use a mic. Maybe you can hear me, but I need Brother Jerome to come up. And Linda, you come up with him, please. Well, this is Pastor Appreciation Month. And, you know, we know these two are a tremendous team that we have. And we know that their motivation is the love that they have for each one of you in our church congregation. And we've been blessed by their leadership and by the way that they've treated us. It's an amazing thing. If anything, this past week has only enhanced the appreciation we have for both of them.
Amen.
We pray God's blessings on you. We pray the best for each of you. But on behalf of the church, I'd like to present to you a small gift and appreciation for all of you. God bless you.
You saw where that went, didn't you? Church, thank you so much. Linda and I have truly been blessed to be a part of this family. It is a family.
Amen.
Be a part of this family for over 28 years now. And I can't think of being anywhere else. Seriously, it has been a joy to be a part of this family for that length of time. Even though Jimmy reminds me from time to time that the reason why you've allowed me to stay here 28 years is because of the piano player. Told someone this morning, they said, "Surely you're not preaching." I said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "You may get out at 11:30. It's 25 after 11 now." But yeah, I'm going to preach. I've got something on my heart that I'm, as the old boy says, I just hope I can get it out the way God put it in.
Amen.
Yeah, I do. I'm going back to the book of 1 John. And we're going to read a passage of scripture this morning from the book of 1 John. It's going to be 1 John chapter 4. And I'm going to read verses 7 through 11. And I'm going to share with you the second message in a series of messages entitled Things Loved, Things to Love, and Things Not to Love. Let me repeat that. Things loved, things to love, and things not to love. I've heard this expression just about all my life, and I take it with understanding. I love everything. Well, that's wrong if you do. There are some things we're not supposed to love. But I don't think you're going to get that part of it this morning. This morning, I'd like to explore things to love. But before we read our scripture, before I give you sort of a, as Brother Doc says, a flyover of where we were, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for this opportunity once again to be able to share another portion of your word, to be able to preach a message from your word. Father, I pray that the things that would be said would be things that would be of you. I pray, Father, that the things that are said would speak to our hearts today. I do pray for the recall of this message, the leadership of it. I pray for the recall of your word and the leadership of it, that in all things you might be magnified, glorified, and honored. For it's in Christ's name I pray, and I ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Let's read 1 John chapter 4, just a few verses. I'm not going to read all the scripture that I read at the beginning of the first message in this series. I'm going to read 1 John chapter 4, starting at verse 7. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Very interesting. I'm going to read further, but that's a very interesting phrase. Let's read that phrase once again. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. There are folks that think that they truly do love others, but they're not Christians. That passage of scripture teaches me that in order to really know what love is, you first of all have to know God.
Amen.
You may think you really love someone, and there may be some elements of love in there, but to really love someone, you must first love God.
Amen.
Let's read on. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. I'll pause my reading right there. Let's just take a glance backwards just for a moment at what we looked at in the first installment of this series. I shared with you that a very interesting thing is that the Apostle John probably wrote as much, if not more, about love than any of the other apostles. In the book of 1 John alone, he uses, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he uses the word love 4-6 times. Now, if you look, 1 John only has 5 chapters to it. And they're not very long chapters at that. And in those 5 chapters, John makes reference to the word love 46 times. Those 46 times are expressed in only 26 verses. Someone accused me one time, said, you repeat yourself a lot. I know I do. It seemed like me, John repeated himself a lot. If in 26 verses, 46 times, he reminded me about love.
Yeah.
And he reminds you about love. And in those verses of scripture, John tells us this. He says that we are to understand that there are some things that are loved, and there are things that we are to love, and there are some things we're not to love. And so we started this series by looking, first of all, at sort of an overview and looking at what John said about who was loved or what was loved. And we discovered that that was, pardon my pun, us's. That was you and I. Or should I say you and me? We are the loved.
Yeah.
We can rejoice in the fact that God loves us.
Amen.
And needless to say, he gave the greatest thing that he could give to prove that love. He gave his son, Jesus, to die on the cross of Calvary,
right,
to pay a debt that I could not pay, a debt that you could not pay. God loved you so much that he gave his son to show that he loved you. And to make the way of reconciliation that we refer to as salvation. You know what's interesting to me? What's interesting to me is that I think the biggest issue facing our society today is a lack of love. A lack of love. And folks, you know, if I just looked at society in general, just in our country in general, you can see a lack of love of people towards people. But it's not just in society that we see it. We can bring it on home, and we can see a development of a lack of love amongst Christian people. Now, you may not agree with me. You may not agree with me. But I believe that we have lost focus of what it is that we're supposed to be doing. And what we're supposed to be doing has a motor that drives what we're supposed to be doing. And that motor that drives what we're supposed to be doing is love.
Amen.
It's love. Yes. We're not only supposed to be salt and light to the world, but we are supposed to be God's radiance of love to the world.
Amen.
I'm going to share with you some scripture. I hope I get to it this morning. If I don't, you'll eventually get it if you'll come back. You'll eventually get it. Listen, one of our reasons for God leading us here as Christians is so that we can radiate the love of God. So that people can see that God is love.
Yes.
But I do believe that we're living in a day where the application of love is at a low ebb. And even within the church, there's too many Christians that are making judgments against others simply because they don't see things the way that I see them, or you see them, or we see them. Folks, I am taught in God's word, judge not.
Amen.
Lest ye also be judged.
Amen.
We're to love. And I'm getting ahead of myself. But in the first installment, we addressed the lack of love, at least in many respects.
Mm-hmm.
The appearance of a lack of love. And we saw that God loved us. And I made that point because of something that I read, discovered in the preparation of this series, that says there is evidence right there that we're lacking in love. This is a 2022 statistic. In 2022, in the U.S. survey, there were 49,476 suicidal deaths in America. That averages out to be one death from suicide every 11 minutes. And those that are in the know about these things say the leading cause of people committing suicide is that they feel not loved. They feel not loved. Boy, this was the one that really, you've heard the old expression, knock my socks off. This knocked my socks off. In the age group of 10 to 14. How many can remember that far back? In the age group of 10 to 14, And why there's a skip, I'm not sure. But then in the age group of 25 to 34, did you know that suicide was the second leading cause of death? And if what we've been told is true, 10 to 14-year-old children are taking their lives because they don't think somebody loves them. Yeah. In the prime of life, at age 25 to 34, young people are taking their life, second leading cause of death, because they think nobody loves them. God says, I love you. I love you. And I prove my love to you because I gave my son to meet your every need. So now let's move on to the second installment of this. Things to love. Well, I've got so much to say about this, I have wrapped myself around that old, I don't know what the proper terminology is, so I'll just say I've wrapped myself around this axiom so many times, trying to get formulated in my mind how to present this, and folks, I'm not sure how it's going to be presented. I don't know, that may have been what caused my issue this past week. No, you're laughing. John knew, in writing this scripture under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, John knew that he was loved. I hope you know that today. I hope you know that. And then he goes on to tell us, here are some things you need to love. But before I address the ones we're supposed to love, let me share this with you. You know, the scripture says much about the importance, the benefit for those who do love. We find most of that here, as my daddy-in-law used to say, little John. We find many of these benefits in what John writes on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit about love. Look at 1 John chapter 2, verse 10. 1 John chapter 2, verse 10. And I'm only going to read just part of the verse because I'm going to come back to it in a little bit. 1 John chapter 2, verse 10. He who loves his brother abides in the light. He who loves his brother abides in the light. How many of you love darkness? Now I know it aids in sleep. But I will be honest with you, I'm not a big fan of darkness. As the old expression goes, I like to see where I'm going. As the old expression goes, I like to see what's in front of me. As the old expression goes, I like to see what they look like.
Amen.
And I can't do that without life. Those are things in the physical realm. Let me talk about something more important than the physical realm. Let me talk about the spiritual realm. You see, the fleshly realm is going to give way and go back to the dust of the ground. But the spiritual realm of me, of you, when God made us, he made us for eternity.
Yeah.
I've said it many times, I say it again. I'm not waiting to live in eternity. I am living in eternity.
That's right. That's
right. Right now, I am living in eternity. The temporary place I'm living in eternity right now is in a body of clay.
Yeah.
But one day, I will give up the body of clay.
Right.
And at some point in the future, I'm going to get a glorified body fashioned like another to the body of Christ.
Amen.
A glorified body.
Yes.
That will never again, ever again feel pain. Never, ever again feel any type of sadness. never again to have to go to a funeral home.
Right.
Never again to experience the downfalls of this life. But it will be a life fashioned likened unto the life of Christ.
Yes,
amen.
God says, the way I see myself through the spiritual realm, through the spiritual life, is to love.
Yes,
right.
Amen.
To love. A benefit of loving as we are supposed to love is to have the light.
Amen.
Someday I'm going to get her to do it. It's been a while, so it's going to take some getting, a whole lot of getting to get her to do it. I've written a few songs. And one of them was entitled The Light of Day. And Linda used to sing it quite often. One of these days I'm going to get her to sing it for you. And the light of that day is Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Folks, we need to love because we see things the way we need to see things spiritually. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, what else am I the beneficiary of love? Well, Scripture says, 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he's in the light, then we have fellowship one with another. We have fellowship one with another. No, I'm not going there. Yes, I am. I've heard people say, I just can't bear being around me. No, you've never said that, have you? You've never thought that, have you? It's never crossed your mind to turn and go another direction because you saw somebody coming towards you that you didn't really like being around. You've never done that, have you? Scripture says, but if we walk in the light as he's in the light, then we have fellowship one with another. It makes fellowship so much sweeter.
Yes.
When we love people, and I'm jumping ahead, when we love people, even when we don't like their ways.
Yeah.
That's a benefit. I like the Latin part of that verse when it says, excuse me, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Do you know that the love of Christ, the love of God in our life, do you know it reveals who we are and who we've been with? I'm going to tell you, I start saying childhood story. And if you go back to when Linda and I got married, we were still children, so I guess it is a childhood story. I've told people many a time she finished raising me. I remember I got on this kick of them big belt buckles. Any of you ever get on that kick? Some of you got them now, don't you? Big belt buckles. One of mine said, God is love. God is love. That's a good message, isn't it? Sure it is. Another one said, Jesus is Lord.
Yeah.
Good saying, right? We adorn ourselves, maybe not as conspicuously as we used to, but we want people to know that we're Christians. And that's okay. Absolutely, it is okay. As a matter of fact, if you're a Christian, somebody else don't know it, your witness is not too good.
Right.
People ought to know. I like I like a little country music. I'll be honest with you. If it's sinful, I'll ask God to forgive me. All right. But one of my favorite singers was an old boy from up around Smithville, Tennessee. And he sung a song that I just thoroughly liked. You got to stand for something or you'll fall for anything.
That's right.
I said to myself, first time I heard that, that'll preach. You got to stand for something or you'll fall for anything. If you're not showing that you stand for something, and I trust that is Jesus Christ, that is God,
amen,
then you're not being as effective. I'm not being as effective as I should. And listen, wear those belt buckles if you want to wear them. That God is love. That Jesus Christ is Lord. Wear them. But I'm going to tell you the number one thing that's going to show people that you're a child of God. And you want to guess what? Well, I'll tell you. It's love.
Amen.
I want you to read it with me. I want you to read it with me. I want you to go to John chapter 13. That's not little John. This is big John. John chapter 13. I'm going to read 10 verses of scripture. John chapter 13. I'll start reading at verse 34. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. More to be said about that later. But Jesus is giving a command. Now, I'm going to pause this for a moment. There are certain people that have given me commands that I chose to ignore. You know, like the guy sitting at the red light that waves at him, one finger wave at him. Jesus didn't ignore that. Someone sat down on their horn. I usually choose to ignore that. Although my dear says, pull your horn back at him. Now, sad to say, there's been some commands that I've been given in life that I chose to ignore. My, I wish I hadn't chose to. Reasons behind that. But you know what? Y'all remember back years and years and years ago, there was a cliche advertisement that says, when E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens.
Yeah.
Y'all remember something along those lines? Well, let me tell you, you don't have to listen to everything E.F. Hutton said. I don't even know if E.F.'s alive or not. I didn't listen to him. See my checkbook, you know. You know I didn't. Little human. But I'm going to tell you something. When Christ speaks, we need to listen.
Amen.
And Christ says to every one of us, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Listen to what he says. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. Watch out for this. By what? By what? That's a question. By what? Do you know the answer? By what? What's he talking about? What? Do y'all see it? He's talking about love. Do y'all see that?
Yes.
Not just any kind of love, but love to one another. Yes. Hey, y'all.
Yeah.
Yeah. One to another. And he says, by this, all will know that have love for one another.
Yes.
How are people going to know that you and I are Christians? Tell me. Is it by your belt buckle? Is it by your pants? Is it by your Christian flag? Understand, all those things are good. Those are good.
Yeah.
But Jesus says the way people are going to know you are mine is by the way you love one another.
Amen.
So if you're a child of God, if you profess Jesus Christ as your Savior, please don't be a simulacus. Don't be that kind of person that people want to walk away from when they see you coming. That'll preach.
Yes.
Yep. Well, apparently by the amens, you may not agree with me. Do you know there's something else affected by the way we love one another? Let's read that. 1 John. Back to Luke John. 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 14. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. You ever had to swallow a horse before? Let me say it again. Have you ever had to swallow a horse before? Being raised in the South, that's what they call the great big old pill that you were given for this, that, and the other. And some of them, I can understand why they were called horse pills. You had to have a mouth like a horse to be able to swallow something like that. Yeah. Can I give you a horse pill? Can I give you a spiritual horse pill? You know why Christians often have doubts about their relationship with God? Do you know why some Christians have continuous thoughts about, am I really saved? I'm not going to ask for a show of hands for those that have ever had doubts. But if I were to ask that question, I wonder how many hands would go up. I would have to raise mine. I would. I'd have to raise mine. There have been times of doubts. God, do you really love me? God, have I really been saved? And it really comes along when you have to say to yourself, well, if I was a Christian, I wouldn't have done that, would I? Have you ever had those kind of thoughts? Well, I'll break my word. I do want to say a show of hands. How many of you ever had doubts about your salvation? Really? Some of you are just like my dearest girl. Your pennies on. I told some people one time, I never met but one man in my life that told me that he never doubted or had a doubt about his salvation. That was Uncle Asa. You know what Uncle Asa told me? Midway Baptist Church one night, years ago. And he said, I'd swing out over hell on a rotten cornstalk. I know I'm saved. How about you? You swing out over hell on a rotten cornstalk? Are you that secured in your relationship with Christ and with God? You say, I am now. That's good. That's good. The older I've gotten, through the Word, through the ministering of the Spirit,
yes,
I am more confident today than ever before that I am saved and I know where I'm going.
Amen.
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 But some are not that confident.
Right. Yes.
And you know what part of the cause of that could very well be? A lack of love.
Right.
That's right.
Isn't that what the scripture said?
Right.
Let's just see that one more time. John. Oh, pardon me. 1 John. Chapter 3, verse 14. It says, these words. We know that we have passed from death to life. That sounds like security to me. That's deep. Come on, man. Does that sound like security?
Yes.
Yes.
Because we love the brethren.
Right.
He who does not love his brother abides in death. You know what death is? If you had to define death, I made it much longer than I thought I was going to do. I mean, I'm just feasting in the word this morning.
Amen.
Do you know what death is? Yeah, I know what it is. Yeah, we think of death, we normally think of this physical body dying or somebody else's physical body dying, right? Do you know that that is just an illustration of death? You know what death really is? Death is separation. The Bible speaks of three kinds of death. One is before a person gets saved. They're separated from God. So the scripture says in the book of Ephesians something along these lines. That she that is living in sin is dead.
Yeah.
The second death that is mentioned in Scripture is when a person gets saved, their old sinful nature dies. I mean, they still have to deal with sin, but the life that they once had has changed.
Right.
It's like the words that... John Newton, I believe he was, wrote Amazing Grace, right? And if you don't know, you do like that. You know, it's been attributed to John Newton that he made this statement, I know I'm not what I should be. I know I'm not what I could be. But thank God I'm not what I used to be.
Amen.
Amen.
That's passing from death unto life. There's in that category the death of the physical body, and then there is the second death, which is called the eternal lake of fire.
Yeah.
Okay. What does it mean? 1 John 3, verse 14 says, he that loveth not abides in death. You cannot be as close to God as you need to be if you do not love.
That's right.
I cannot be as close to God as I need to be if I do not love people. Okay. I give you this, and I know. I'm going to go ahead and tell you those that we are to love. I'm not going into them. That's for next Sunday, Lord willing. But we are told to love certain ones. Who are the ones that we are told to love? We are told to love God. We are told to love Jesus. We are told, and this is going to catch you now. You got to be here next Sunday. You got to hear this. You are told to love yourself. You are told to love yourself. Oh, I wrestle with that. You know. Praise the Lord. Glory to God.
Yes, yes.
You are told to love your family. You are told, I am told to love my neighbor. So Somebody say, I live out in the middle of nowhere, I ain't got no neighbors. Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. Who's the best biblical example of being a neighbor? A Samaritan. A Samaritan. He became a neighbor to someone in trouble. And last, I know a lot of Baptists don't want to hear this one. You're told to love your enemies. And we're going to explore every one of those as we progress through this. My question to you this morning is this. Do you know you are loved? If you don't, I want you to know you are loved.
Amen.
Amen.
God loves you.
That's right.
My second question to you is this. Do you understand the benefits of loving the way God would have us to love one another? I didn't cover them all. I really just probably touched the icing on the cake with that. Many other benefits. And do you realize the importance of your love? That it shows the world who you belong to.
That's right. Say it again.
Your love shows the world who you really belong to.
Right.
Yeah. We're going to go further. But right now, let's ask the Lord to bless what we've done. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to share the word. Lord, I thank you for the strength you've given me to be able to proclaim it this morning. And I just ask, Father, that you continue to bless us. Lord, to let us see what love truly is. See who we're to love, benefits of loving others. And then, Father, as we eventually get to it, help us to understand there's some things we shouldn't love. Bless these that are gathered here today. If there is one that is not a Christian, may today they be saved. A Christian that needs to rededicate, recommit their mind, that they will do it, Father. Even if they do it where they sit, where they stand, or if they come to this altar, Lord, I pray that they will commit themselves to you. If someone you are dealing with to become a part of this church family, to work with us, help us. I pray they come today and unite with us. I ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Jim, what number are we singing?
Just as I am.